Principal,
So,
shall we start?
yeah, start.
Okay, Swami.
Okay, sir. Good morning to all our dignitaries, guests, and delegates with great joy. It gives me immense pleasure to extend to you a very warm welcome on behalf of LBS College of Engineering, Kasaragod, who has clubbed all of us for the faculty development program named An Insight to Engineering Fluid Dynamics and Its Application in Industry. Thermofluid science has an essential role in mechanical engineering curriculum. Many students find this is a difficult subject to understand. Classroom discussions and engaging students with real life experiences can boost the interest and motivation of students for the course. Instructor may emphasize simple and familiar real-world settings like economic, environmental, and safety aspects of solutions and relevance of basic concepts and principles in daily life. Even though the objective of FTP is to equip the faculty members of various engineering colleges in identified thrust area, the real beneficiaries will be student community and researchers under the university. There is a pool of eminent resource persons comprising academicians, scientists, and industrial experts from institutions of industry, international and national reputation. We wish that the faculty from various colleges will be utilizing this opportunity to strengthen their understanding by getting an insight to the engineering fluid dynamics and its industrial applications. Now, I would like to request Professor Swaraj Kumar of Mechanical Engineering Department to deliver the welcome speech.
Thank you. Thank you to everyone who joined us this morning. I'm extremely delighted to be here and address you all. Before we carry on this with this events, I would give my regards and appreciation to all the people who made this FTP a reality. This could not have been possible without the sheer contribution of you in such a hard times. On that note, let me welcome our chief guest of this faculty development program, Dr. Yunus Angel. He's a renowned author in thermal and fluid sciences and professor emeritus at the University of Nevada, Reno, USA. On behalf of Department of Mechanical Engineering, I welcome Dr. Yunus Angel to this function. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. A pleasure to
Thanks,
be here.
Sir. Welcome our principal, Dr. Mohammad Shakur, who has given all the help and support for this FDP. On behalf of Department of Mechanical Engineering, I welcome Dr. Mohammad Shakur to this event. Welcome, sir. Now, I welcome our head of the department, Vinod sir, my colleagues and friends to this function. I bid a very warm welcome to all the renowned speakers and delegates who took out their valuable time and joined us today to be a part of this faculty development program. We are honored to have you all with us. On behalf of Department of Mechanical Engineering, I welcome you all this great event. I'm closing the speech. I hope everyone is well aware of the themes concerning the FDP. I'm looking forward to many more such programs, engaging more people and on a greater level. To conclude, I wish you all great success in your pursuits. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Your thought-provoking address set up a platform for our speakers to deliver their presentation. Ladies and gentlemen, now I request head of the mechanical department, Professor Vinod Oyam, for the presidential address.
Thank you, Sati. Good morning, all of you. Respected chief guest of the function, world-famous author and academician, Dr. Yunus S. Angel, sir. Our beloved principal, Dr. Mohammad Shukru, sir, deans of our institution, Praveen, sir, and Vinajol, sir, then coordinators of the program, Dr. Abubakar Kadangal, sir, and Professor Swaraj Kumar, my dear colleagues and teachers of KTU, Kerala Technological University, from all over Kerala. So, it is with immense pleasure and proud that I am here presiding over this inaugural function for the faculty development program titled inside to engineering fluid dynamics and its applications in industry. I hope that this 5 days program will be certainly a remarkable event for the department and a benefiting one for the faculty members of KTU. As the title of the program shows, our intention here is to have a more practical oriented approach for the very familiar area of fluid dynamics. And as you can see in the brochure, resource persons from all over the world and multidisciplinary areas are handling various sessions. My special congratulations to the coordinators for arranging such a vast and versatile experts within limited time. And the special attraction here, it will be the presence of our chief guest, Dr. Yunus Singhal sir. While going through the program schedules of this event, many delegates were astonished to see a most familiar names there as the chief guest for the function, who is also going to provide a keynote address. Yes, we are very lucky and proud to have such a wonderful personality here as our chief guest. Till this instant, only his name and only his books were very familiar to us. But now we can proudly announce that Dr. Yunus Singhal has become part of our program. So I would also like to utilize this opportunity for expressing our gratitude towards this legend. Very thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Well, we are nowadays witness with many unfamiliar events, happenings, and setbacks. Scenarios are getting changed. Our expectations and even dreams are exposed to diversions, and even new dimensions start taking into possessions. Daily, we are facing newer environments. Uncertainty seems to be there at every nook and corner. But remember, this is a journey, and we will have to face future looking forward only in the positive directions and learning from past 10%. So with this brief background message, I would like to invite our respected principal, Dr. Mohammad Shakur sir, for officially inaugurating the function. So thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. It's time now to start the proceedings of our program. I would like to invite Professor Dr. Mohammad Shukurti, Principal LBS College of Engineering, Kasaragod, for inaugurating the 5-day online faculty development program, An Insight to Engineering Fluid Dynamics and Its Applications in Industry, sponsored by APJ Abdul Kalam Technological University. Sir.
Respected President of the function, Sri Vinod Voyam, our chief guest, Professor Yunus Ali Singhal, deans, head of the department, other colleagues, participants, all of you, very good morning. We just finished an inauguration program. It was at 9 o'clock in the civil engineering department. So again, this program, it shows how useful these online platforms are for knowledge sharing. Only when we use it effectively. Particularly, availability of very eminent professors like our chief guest, Professor Yunus, and many other eminent professors across the world are available to share their knowledge and experiences with us. If not for this, online platforms wouldn't have been possible. And we are actually, till last year, we didn't know such a possibility is available also. So now we are all used to it. Now it is only, the only requirement now is to make maximum use of this. Our mechanical engineering department are experienced in conducting programs like this. We have very efficient and experienced faculties and other departments who can successfully complete this. But at the same time, the participants, always I request all the participants to be very sincere in approaching this online platforms, because like other offline platform, we have no strict monitoring of attendances in these cases. Only the participants' sincerity or internal sincerity will speak the success of such programs. Whatever programs we have conducted in the last 1 year, we could do this successfully. I wish this program also, the presence of our chief guest, Professor Yunus Tanjil Sir, will not be go wasted. I sincerely think all the participants will make maximum use of this. So with this few words, I declare that this faculty development program is started. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I invite our respected chief guest, Professor Dr. Yunus A. Sanger, Professor Emeritus, University of Nevada, Reno, USA, to addressing the audience.
Thank you very much, and good morning to everybody. It is a pleasure to be here. The beauty of technology, I am right now in Turkey and you are in India, like worlds apart, yet we can be together in this event here. And I would like to thank all the organizers, especially professors Vinod O.M., Muhammad Sekur, Professor Kumar, Vinod George, and also the professor I have communicated with, Ebubekir Kadengal. I thank you all very much, and I hope this will be a good and very beneficial event. As a warm-up, I would like to say that now this program is about fluid mechanics, but let's keep in mind that the science is really one. We have only one science. And then since our mind is limited, we cannot comprehend it all, because that science consists of all the rules, regulations, laws, principles of our nature. We break it apart into manageable pieces, and fluid mechanics is one of them. But sometimes, later we forget to connect the pieces, and then we kind of get lost in one area, whether it is fluids, thermal, heat, mechanics, whatever. So it is very important, I think, we can connect the pieces. That is, show all the connections of fluid mechanics to other areas, including economics, so that we have a holistic picture. And I understand that this program is kind of based on industrial applications, not only fundamentals. And in industry, it has to be that way anyway. We have to have a holistic approach and then see all aspects of a problem. And fluid mechanics is one of them. So within this context, if we do it that way, I think we will get the whole picture in a balanced manner. And also, we will understand the fluid mechanics or any other topic in context relative to others. So that will be very useful. And in my lecture, I'll try to to kind of show the basics of fluid mechanics, and I think the importance of simplicity, because often we get involved in, you know, so many complex things, we forget the fundamentals, the basics. And I will try to emphasize that to set the stage for this great event here. Oh, with that, I would like to greet everybody, all the attendants, and I wish you all, and I hope this will be a great program, and thank you for the invitation.
With all our due respect, we would like to thank you for your presence at the Faculty Development Program and for delivering such speech. We really appreciate you taking out time for us from your busy schedule. It's always been our pleasure to have you with us, and we look forward to seeing you again for the upcoming keynote data session. Once again, thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, now I may request Professor Dr. Praveen Kumar K, Dean of Academics, LBS College of Engineering, Kasaragod, to felicitate our chief guest.
Respected principal, our today's chief guest, other dignitaries assembled here, my dear colleagues, participants of this FDP, my dear friends, a very good morning. I'm really happy to know that today it is the second FDP inauguration in our college. One by the Civil Engineering Department is already inaugurated. This is the second one. So really it is inspiring to, and it's proud to, for all of us, at the faculty members and stakeholders of our institution is putting a large effort to keep up growing with the trends of the industry. Today's topic, engineering fluid dynamics and its applications, is very relevant. And conducting these FDPs help us in growing in different ways, like it will guide the research process with the necessary knowledge and skills to undertake a piece of research work from that. And it will help us to train the researchers in various tools and techniques. Similarly, those who are attending from other domain, like a person like me, even doesn't know the basics of the fluid dynamics or basic terminologies of this topic. It will be beneficial for us also, because we have people have knowledge in their own domain. By knowing what is happening in this particular topic or a particular area, probably they may be able to correlate with the problems of their domain with the problems in this domain. So that interdisciplinary researchers will be the output of these such events. So definitely, I request all the participants to attend it with full sincerity and support the expert faculties, so that it will be more interactive. I wish all the success for this program, and I congratulate the coordinators for conducting it in a good manner. And at the same time, I thank for giving me an opportunity to be a part of this program. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir, for your wishes. Now we would like to call Professor Dr. Abubakar Karangal for a vote of thanks, and then end the program with keynote session, developing an intuitive understanding of thermal fluid science.
Dr. Principal, President of this program, Professor Vinod Oyam, and today's chief guest, Professor Yunus Ali Sanjal, my dear colleagues and participants. I am very happy at this moment because we have just inaugurated our FTP one, an insight to the engineering fluid dynamics and its applications in industry. Also, we had a great, eminent, renowned personality in the field of thermal and fluids, who is well known and doesn't need any introduction to the community of students and faculty members who are in mechanical, chemical, or any automobile, aerospace, or all related branches. So my duty is to express thanks to that. So first of all, I thank the principal, Dr. Mohammad Shakur, for providing full support for the conduction of the faculty development program. Also, I like to extend my thanks to our director, Dr. Abdul Rahman, who was to be present here, but due to some emergency schedule, he could not attend this program. So I thank head of the department, Professor Vinod, who was involved throughout in making this program a success. Then I all the colleagues and faculty and staff of the mechanical department who were also fully devoted and involved in making this program a success. Also, I thank all the participants. Without this participant, this program cannot take place. So the success of the this program lies how much this will be beneficial to the participants. So I request all the participants to utilize this opportunity to carefully attending all the sessions by the expert from various fields. With the so once again, we are the attraction of this FTP, I say that is the presence of the Professor Yunus Sanjal. So I thank you, sir, for accepting our as soon as I contacted you, you very willingly accepted our request and came to. So it may be not a very good convenient time. Program in well before the time, scheduled time. Thank you, sir. Thank you all for your participation in this program. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I am profusely elated to take an opportunity to introduce our chief guest of the day, Yunus Sanjal. He is Professor Emeritus at the University of Nevada, Reno, USA, and the founding dean of the Faculty of Engineering at Adnan Menderes University in Ain, Turkey. He received his PhD in Mechanical Engineering from North Carolina State University in USA before joining ADU in 2012. He held the position of Dean of the Faculty of Mechanical Engineering at Yildiz Technical University, YTU, and as advisor to President at Scientific and Technological Research Council to BTAC on International Cooperation. Professor Sanjal served as the Assistant Director and Director of the Industrial Assessment Center at UNR for 8 years. He also served as the advisor to several government organizations and private companies on energy efficiency, renewable energy, energy policies, and education reform. Professor Sanjal is the author or co-author of widely adopted textbooks, Thermofluid Engineering Approach, Fundamentals of Thermofluid Sciences, Heat and Mass Transfer, Fundamentals and Applications, Fluid Mechanics, Fundamentals and Applications, Differential Equations for Scientists and Engineers, Fundamentals and Applications of Renewable Energy and Energy Efficiency and Management for Engineers, all published by McGraw-Hill. Some of his textbooks have been translated into Chinese, Japanese, Korean, Thai, Spanish, Portuguese, Turkish, Italian, Greek, and French. Dr. Sanjal has received several keynote and invited lectures at technical conferences and academic institutions. He is the recipient of several outstanding teaching awards, and he has received the ASEE Miriam Wiley Distinguished Author Award for Excellence in Authorship twice. On behalf of Mechanical Engineering Department, I thank him for providing his gracious presence to join us today to enhance our joy. So please.
Okay, thank you very much for the presentation. Now I am new to this program, so I think, let me see. Now you can see my presentation, I assume.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, I'll leave it this way so that I can control it better. Let me see. No. Let me see. Yeah, okay, let's do it this way. First of all, again, thank you very much for the invitation, and I hope this will be a very beneficial program. And it is a pleasure for me to be here. I have been in India a few times before, so I met, I think, many of my colleagues there. Because of COVID, obviously, things are being done online right now, but it makes it also easy. That is, without any travel, we can communicate, you know, exchange ideas, have discussions. So I think COVID also showed that we don't have to leave our homes in order to do some joint events as we are doing right now. And in my presentation, I will try to emphasize the simplicity and the importance of intuitive approach. And often we dwell on complications so much that we often forget the fundamentals, the very simple things, the very basic things. But let's keep in mind that things are in
essence very simple, but somehow we miss that point, because what we are studying in science is really natural phenomena. We see the entire universe, things are happening in certain ways, there is order, there are rules, invisible rules, so we are trying to discover them and express them using the language of mathematics, and then show that those rules apply everywhere, and apply the rules to make predictions, to do analysis, etc. So the whole thing should be, you know, very intuitive, very simple, but somehow we manage to complicate things. Kind of show that it is not really easy, it is difficult. It is not that way. I think things are simple, comprehensible and manageable. And all we need to do is really visualize the invisible phenomena. It is the ghost that, you know, the forces and the laws of nature that kind of govern the phenomena that we see, the natural phenomena there. And there are a lot of misconceptions that the students bring to class. And one of our job is to really correct those misconceptions. And those misconceptions, they serve as a guide, as an opportunity to show the correct phenomena and why they are misconceptions and why they are common in the society and how to correct them. I'll give some examples of that. And also sometimes we put a lot of emphasis on data. The data we generate, especially with computers, and then the numbers, the nice diagrams, whatever. But keep in mind that data is not knowledge. Unless you interpret the data, unless you make some sense of it, the data is not useful. Therefore, we have a lot of data generated, but the successful engineers are those who kind of discover some patterns, some regularities, and make some sense. In fact, make the best sense of the data in the form of numbers, tables, figures, whatever. So data is, I think, right now very important, because we are drawn in data, and to be selective of data and to make sense of data, it is very, very important. To go back to the simplicity. Now let's start with Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak. You know these guys, the founders of Apple. And in the past, the computers were large. So to use a computer, you will have to go to, you know, computer room in the company or university, whatever. And it was kind of unimaginable that you would have your own computer. So what Steve Jobs did together with Wozniak is they started the PC business in an intuitive way. Let's say we used to use a DOS operating system in the past. You have to use the commands. It was very difficult. So what they did is they made it intuitive. That is, using a computer doesn't require you to be an engineer or computer scientist or very smart guy. Anyone can use it. That is simplicity. So because of that simplicity, the computers became accessible. Now everybody is using them. So simplicity is, I think, the most important thing. And now we have a lot of programs, for the online training, communication, whatever. And I think the leader in the market is Zoom. The reason is, it is very simple. You don't need any training. Very intuitive, okay? And other programs I use rarely, but Zoom, I see it everywhere. Is it any different than others? Not really. In the past, we had Skype. but it was so difficult to use. It was like, you know, oh boy. But with Zoom, things became very simple there. And in order to compete with Zoom, I think the program will have to be powerful, simple, and intuitive. Otherwise, it will remain on the top there. And again, on simplicity. Now we have electric cars and hydrogen cars, right? At a conference, somebody asked me about the future of hydrogen and electric cars, like beginning of 2000s. And there was hardly any hydrogen and electric cars, and people were discussing what the future will be. And I told them, well, I don't know where the technology will take us, but based on mere simplicity, electric cars are very simple, okay? They don't have any moving parts. They don't have any membranes that are prone to really going back and being plugged there. And I said, based on simplicity and the easy access to electricity everywhere, including our homes, no moving parts, the electric cars should prevail. I don't need to know anything else. Just they are simple, okay? So simplicity is, you know, powerful. And another concept I would like to emphasize is integration, okay? That is, simplicity is good, but integration may be very powerful. Example, the iPhone in 2007. If you look at iPhone, okay, it really had nothing new. Still, you know, we had like, you know, cell phones, we had internet, we had widescreen, touchpads, like, you know, iPod, connections, cameras, all that. Okay, what was unique about iPhone? It put everything together, okay? Instead of having many devices, you could do all those things in one device and in a seamless, intuitive way. That is, simplicity was there, but simply integration. Apple did not invent any of those. Apple just does the, you know, the software and then takes the pieces and designs the products there. So I think integration, when you integrate seemingly unrelated areas, combine them in one product, I think that is a signature of success there. In the future, for example, we will see these the devices like this. We know cars very well. We know photovoltaics, right? And right now we see products that combine them. And now, is that product successful right now? Probably not. It looks very ugly, really. I don't think I'll buy that car. So what is the challenge? To really combine technologies like cars and photovoltaics, but to really make it attractive, make it artistic, make it, you know, elegant, so that when you see it, you say like, oh, I want to drive this car. I want to own this car. I want, let's say, to show off with this car. And the artists will play a great part here. Kind of, you know, making artistic, almost invisible, or aesthetically very appealing. That is, again, not only a technological wonder, fuel efficient, but also other aspects. So we need to do all those things. And the real world, let's say pedagogically, when we learn and when we teach, okay, simply relating the science to everyday life. Okay, you will do this in an industrial context in this course, but not only industrial applications, the applications in our home, okay? For example, when the food is hot, we simply blow on the food, right? Like pizza or other things, whatever, and it gets cooler. But the funny thing is, our breath is warmer than the environment air there. So from heat transfer point of view, people may get confused. The air in the room is cool, and your breath is warm relatively, and you are like, you know, forcing your breath on the food. And unless you mention this, people don't realize it. And then, of course, this creates an opportunity to really teach convection in heat transfer. Why? Because convection is heat conduction, which is a diffusion phenomena, and fluid mechanics. That is a bulk fluid motion there. And when you involve fluid motion together with heat diffusion, which is the conduction, then heat transfer goes up drastically. Okay, and we call that convection. It is nothing new. We have been doing this, you know, since we were a child. That is blowing on the food using warm air. Yet it is more effective from heat transfer point of view. We think that we get cold in cold air, like 5 degrees outside here. Yet if we have a high heat source here, you feel warm. So this is the radiation. So radiation doesn't need to heat the environment. Okay, it is direct. Whereas the heat conduction and convection, it depends on the temperature of the medium there. And let's say summertime, we use fans, right? In Turkey, in India, USA, everywhere. And the funny thing is, in thermodynamics, you learn fans generate heat because it consumes electricity, and then it is converted to mechanical energy, to heat through friction, and eventually, even that mechanical power, okay? It is even that mechanical energy, which is first converted to kinetic energy, it is also converted to heat, because heat is the lowest form of energy. Therefore, if this is like a 50 watt fan or 100 watt fan, it is equivalent to 100 watt electric heater, which means in winter you can use your fan as a heater, okay? But we don't do that. So why do we use the fan for cooling? Again, convection. It is warming the air slightly, raising the temperature, which is bad in summer, right? Yet it is moving the air so much, increasing the convection coefficient, the heat transfer between our body and the surrounding slightly warmer air is now greater. So although it is a heat generating device, we use it for cooling. This gives us the means to really understand and explain convection. And to use it effectively, obviously, you shouldn't close the windows, because eventually the temperature inside will rise. So you need the fresh air, okay, so that there is no temperature rise there. And then you use the fan to increase the convection coefficient there. Okay, now we have normally in the cars mirrors, right? The side mirrors, and we have to have it because we want to see what is behind us in traffic. In fluid mechanics, we know that any irregularity like that will cause drag. It will increase the drag there, right? If let's say you are working to improve the fuel efficiency of the cars, one possibility is to get rid of it. The thing is, you know, like our ears, it has to stick out so that there is no other way, because the mirror inside the car, it has a limited viewpoint there. When you look at this from a thermodynamic point of view, fuel efficiency, and the fluid mechanics point of view, which is causing, you know, enhanced drag, therefore more air resistance and more power requirement to overcome the drag. Then you get the idea that is there any way to get rid of the side mirrors for fuel efficiency? And it turns out if you do that, you will save like 2 to 7% fuel, which is significant. Okay, how can you replace it? Well, right now the cameras are well developed. Okay, that is, if you place sufficient number of cameras with a screen inside the car, as you see here, you can really replace the side mirrors. Not only that, you can also eliminate the dead spots there, the blind spots. Okay? So you can even make the car safer. So what do we see here? Integration. The camera technology, okay, the costs are down. So the electronics, you incorporate this with the existing cars, and then you eliminate the side mirrors because they are a major source of drag there, and which means also you eliminate noise because they also generate noise. Not to mention when you drive in narrow streets, sometimes your mirror becomes the victim there. Because they stick out. So again, just keeping an eye on what is happening outside, keeping in mind the integration, incorporation, and marrying different technology. Okay? This way, an ordinary product becomes a new product with some attractive features there. And if it is economic and reliable, then I think you have some commercial success there. And sometimes, simple things. Okay, you see the truck. Normally, the backside of the truck is what? Flat, right? But it turns out that in fluid mechanics, we learn because of this large, back area, the truck generates a pressure drag. Kind of, the pressure difference between the front and back kind of pushes the truck backwards. And it has a large frontal area, and the drag is proportional with that frontal area there. Okay? So it is obviously undesirable. It turns out that if you just add these pieces of metals, okay? Of course, this requires what? Detailed CFD analysis, you can eliminate the vacuum here, reduce it significantly. How much? 6%. And you can save like fuel up to 6%. In the USA, it is worth like over $6 billion, which is good for the environment, good for your pocket, because you will spend what? Less fuel, less money, and also good for sustainability. Okay, so this is what engineering is all about, and this is also the importance of fluid mechanics. You cannot quantify this, you cannot do this analysis unless you know the basics of fluid mechanics. And nowadays, I think the importance of CFD because. The simple equations will not work here. They are good for simple cases, for concepts, but this is a very complicated flow, and you will have to use computers to solve these things here. And similarly, airplanes. If you traveled like in 1970s, 80s, even part of 90s, you will see that the wings of the airplanes, they were really flat, okay? And then, people realize that, I think the experts in the fluid mechanics, the pressure at the top of the wing is low and at the bottom is high. This generates the lift, okay? And here you have the mixing, kind of, the high pressure kind of destroying the low pressure here, rendering the tips of the airplanes useless, okay? So what comes to mind, if I, kind of reshape the wings, okay, kind of tilt them upwards as you see here. Maybe I can eliminate the mix of the flows near the tips, before the wings and above the wings. And okay, the idea is good, but you have to kind of show that it works. You have to quantify it. And all the analysis, you know, experiments, whatever, they show that it results in fuel savings up to 3.5%. Okay. So again, you know, a simple idea, a good command of the basics, intuitive understanding, and an observed approach. You observe, okay, and then you think, okay, and then you get an idea, and then you have the ability to really do the analysis. And it is the reason that fluid mechanics is one of the fundamental sciences in engineering. And sometimes, you know, you can use simple things to explain a lot of phenomena. Example, we all know capillary effect, right? If let's say there is a liquid and there is a tube, low diameter, that fluid will rise or it will drop. What is the reason for that? The fluid mechanics, they have that, you know, force of adhesion there, okay? They stick together. But there is also a force of attraction between the fluid and the solid, okay? The molecules attract each other and form some bonds there, okay? And depending on which effect dominates, the fluid will rise or it will drop before the fluid level here, okay? As you see here. Now, and here's the formula. How much it will rise or drop. This is the surface tension, okay, the radius, the density, and this is the angle here between the solid surface and the fluid surface there. Okay, now this is one of my test questions. Now the question is, we have water and then small diameter tubes, we know that the water will go up, it will rise at this height of h, right? And I can calculate the h from here. Using, you know, small diameter tubes, many of them, I can raise a lot of water. Now the question is, if I drill a hole here, right here, okay, and then stick a tube, or you don't need to stick a tube here. Now, what will happen? Will water leak out like this, or will air flow in, or nothing will happen? Okay. So these are the three choices. Now, it may look like a, you know, a silly question, but using this, I think you can make a lot of points on the intuitive understanding of the basics, using the fundamentals. Okay, for example, what do we know from fluid mechanics? We know that at the horizontal level, unless there is a fluid flow, you know, all those things, stationary fluid like here, the pressure is the same. That is, the pressure here at the interface is the same as the pressure in the tube right here. Okay. We can also show that using the equations. And we also know that pressure increases with depth. Why? Because of the weight of the fluid above. The pressure here is higher because it carries, you know, the weight of that fluid, and it increases linearly because the density here is constant, okay? And intuitively, we feel like if there is a fluid in a cup and then you punch a hole here, the fluid will leak out, right? Now, this is the misconception. Why? Because this is what we have seen in real life. Anytime you punch a hole, okay, in something with some fluid in, fluid leaks out. So the intuitive answer, uneducated answer is the fluid will leak out. Okay? But in this case, it cannot. In this case, the fluid will have to leak, the air will have to leak in. Why? Because the pressure increases with depth, which means it should decrease as you go up. Okay? So the pressure here is the pressure at this point plus the weight of this fluid per unit area. Therefore, the pressure here should be lower. And of course, now the question is, how can it be lower? Okay. If it is lower, that means it is below atmospheric pressure. So what is holding it? Here we have atmospheric pressure. So how can it be lower here? Because that high pressure should push it down, right? Well, this is how we understand surface tension. The water molecules at the surface, they have that attractive force. They are like an elastic membrane. Okay, so obviously they are under stress. It is the reason we call it, surface tension. There is a tension there, and the pressure difference between atmospheric pressure and the water pressure here is really that surface tension, that force there. If there were no surface tension, you wouldn't have this phenomenon. Okay, so I think using an example like this, you can, let's say, explain the surface tension, how to calculate it, whatever, and you can relate it to thermodynamics. I asked this question not in fluid mechanics, but also in thermodynamics. People may have no idea about surface tension. Okay, how can they answer it? Well, I think they have to reason that if I can get the water out, okay, this way, because water will rise naturally. Now I have water at relative high elevation, okay, I can get the water out, and then I have water here. Repeat the process, kind of put another set of tube bundles, okay, raise the water level more, and do this, 5, 10, 20, 50 times. What do we have? Water at maybe 10, 20, 30 meter high. You raise the water level. And then what comes to mind? Well, I have elevation difference, and I can use, thousands of tubes, no problem. I have a lot of water. Then what is the logical thing to do? Run a hydraulic turbine, right? And generate electric power. What happens to that water? It just comes back here. So what do we have? Free power generation. In thermodynamics, what is this called? Perpetual motion machine. Generating electricity without using any energy source. Okay? And thermodynamics says it is against the second law. It is against the first law. You cannot do that. Okay? So based on thermodynamics, water here cannot leak out. Because if it would, then I could create a perpetual motion machine. So then what happens here? The fluids and thermodynamics, they are combined. And sometimes, just concept questions, okay? The thought questions. Einstein is very famous with thought experiments there. Just, in imagination. For discussion, it also clarifies a lot of concepts and results in deeper understanding. For example, we have our air in a rigid tank here, okay? And let's say we are heating this. The question is, how will properties change? Will volume change? Of course not, it is rigid, okay? Will density change? Now, we may be thinking that, it may change because now we are heating this. But again, the fundamentals come to mind. The amount of mass is constant, the total volume is constant, density is the ratio, obviously it cannot change. Kind of, using reasoning of this kind. And you can, let's say, discuss other properties conceptually. And they go a long way. and let's say buoyancy. Okay. For example, we have two bricks, identical, same volume. One is near the surface, okay, and the other is at a deeper part of the lake, okay, where the pressure is much higher. And the question is, what is the force needed to hold the brick at the same level, meaning the buoyancy force here? Is it here in the case of B larger than A, smaller than A, or is it the same? Okay. Now again, intuitively we feel like the pressures here are higher, so I may need a larger force to hold it at a high pressure region. But of course, the right answer is no, because the buoyancy force depends on only the volume occupied and the density of the fluid, nothing else. And then if you also consider the density of the solid, okay, the difference is the lift, the force upwards there. That is, you know, some examples which are counterintuitive, again, helps you make the point there. Let's say another question from fluid mechanics. Let's say you are trying to fill this bucket, okay? And you have this hose here. And the question is, let's say you are holding the hose like this. Will it help if you lower the hose, or it doesn't really matter, okay? And usually we don't think about this, and usually you see people, they just, you know, hold the hose at a high level, right? And you can see the water flowing. But if you look at this from fluid mechanics point of view, we know that the flow rate here is proportional to the pressure, which is expressed as head, okay? The net head there. And if, let's say, you raise this level where the water leaves, let's say the head is 10 meters. If you raise this, the end of the hose, 10 meters, we know that no water will flow. The driving force is really the the head difference there, okay? The elevation difference, the head. So the more you lower, the larger the head and the larger the flow rate. So what is the right thing to do? Lower this hose to the level of the bucket. Then your flow rate will increase and the bucket will fill faster. Okay. Again, you can say that this is, you know, childish, but keep in mind that everybody knows this. Okay. Everybody has filled a bucket. It is in their mind. So when you combine that vivid picture, which is, I think, solidly in the memory, with a fundamental, okay, then you teach the fundamental in a permanent way, okay? So that concept now sticks to the mind because of this experience, this example here. Okay, another question, attaching nozzle, okay? Let's say you are still filling the bucket. Is it better to attach a nozzle to fill the bucket faster, or not to attach it? Again, the intuition. The nozzle is associated with high speed. It is the reason that we use the nozzle, right? And high speed is associated with high flow rate. Now, these are, I think, what is in our head, entrenched there, okay? We are conditioned. So what is the first response? Well, you know, this nozzle will increase the speed, okay? So the bucket will fill faster, okay? Now, this answer disregards fluid mechanics. In fluid mechanics, what do we learn? we learn that any fluid section, additional section, okay, involves pressure loss. That is, you don't have anything that doesn't cause pressure loss, no matter what it is. That zero friction surfaces, this and that, they are idealization. It is just like you have, let's say, a copper wire. If you attach another wire there, okay, another piece, like silver, gold, whatever, the resistance will increase and the current will decrease. So any device like this nozzle here, okay, it will introduce an additional head loss. So what is the end result? Since now we have less head, less net pressure, the flow rate will decrease. Although the velocity is increasing. Again, you know, very simple example, but I think makes the point there. Keep in mind that, let's say, in electricity, other than superconductivity, okay, you always have resistance. And let's say you have some highly resistive material. If you add a copper wire at the end, you may feel like the copper, you know, will draw the electrons, the electricity, make it faster. You know, the copper wire will introduce additional resistance, the electric current will decrease. Okay, same here. And let's say conservation of mass, okay? What is entering, what is leaving, the accumulation, whatever. The concepts are usually abstract. If you attach it to something tangible, okay, then again it sticks to the mind. Here, for example, we have a bathtub, right? Everyone knows that. And we have water flowing in, and then water flowing out, and then the water level, you know, increasing, decreasing, just using an example of this kind. And then associating these formulas, okay, with that example, again, we'll make the concepts stick to the mind, okay? This is not only teaching, but also for learning, because it is personal what I do. When I learn something, I try to find an example from my personal life, which is associated with that concept. If I can find a good example, okay, keep in mind association is a very powerful mechanism, okay, for remembering things. And let's say we have the question of mass flow rate of a garden hose, and you don't have any mass flow rate measurement devices, okay? We have done this while visiting a factory for an energy audit. We have seen somewhere that a lot of hot water is coming out from a hose, okay? It is a waste heat, like, you know, 70 degrees. Okay, it is a milk processing plant. And we wanted to quantify the energy loss there, but we didn't have any mass flow rate measuring device. So what did we do there? We simply took a bucket, okay, and then timed how long it takes for the bucket to fill, and then take the ratio, and you get the mass flow rate. And we use that in calculations to show that if they install a heat exchanger there, how much energy and money they can save, and what is the payback period there. That is, again, you know, the basic things. That is using a creative mind and to relate the mass to mass flow rate there. You know, very simple example. For example, throttling valves in refrigeration, okay? In thermodynamics, we learned that the enthalpy is constant. But what is enthalpy? Internal energy plus flow energy, which is PV, okay? And what happens to the fluid as it goes through the valve, okay? What happens to temperature? Probably you will think that the temperature will increase. Why? Because of the pressure losses, frictional heating, whatever, right? And you're right. the temperature should really increase. But look at here. I have a refrigerant at 0.8 megapascal liquid, and then I reduce the pressure by forcing it through a valve or some thin wire to 0.12 megapascal. Okay. Now what happens to temperature? It drops from 31 degrees to minus 22. That is a drop of 53.6 degrees. Of course, you know, did I make a mistake? How can this happen? I expect some heating. Okay. Again, I think this gives you the setting to explain the flow of energy. Okay. And although the pressure here is decreasing, specific volume. See here, the key is there is a lot of evaporation. Okay. And that specific volume increases so much that this P2V2 is much greater than P1V1, so that U2 is conservation of energy much less than U1. Okay. As a result, since internal energy is dropping drastically, the temperature follows. And this is the key of refrigeration. That's it. Just so you know, a thin wire, kind of coil there, or a pressure dropping device, or anything really. And in thermodynamics, we also explain that there is a lot of evaporation here, and that heat of vaporization must come from somewhere. Okay. And that somewhere is the remaining liquid. Okay. So there is no violation of the conservation of energy. Again, in compressible flow, people get confused, you know, to accelerate a fluid, a gas, to very high velocities, okay? Normally, to increase the speed, we are again conditioned to use, you know, nozzles, converging nozzles like this, okay? But you know in fluid mechanics that there is a limit, the speed of sound. You cannot exceed it. And then, to increase the velocity more, what do? You have to take a diverging section, which is counterintuitive. You know, normally when the cross-section area increases, velocity should decrease, right? But again, you know, the basics. Here, the density decreases so much that it more than overcomes the increase in the area there. So the conservation of mass still holds. And also, you know, some other aspects. We do a lot of fluids in fluid mechanics, but we don't pay much attention to motors. Yet we have the pumps, the motors, the efficiency, etc. And the amount of energy consumed or generated is important. So also to involve really motor efficiency and to emphasize the importance of using high efficiency motors. And then to really show the savings, how much money you save by using a motor with an efficiency of, for example, 93% versus 89%. And usually the experts in fluid mechanics, they know fluids. And then the technicians in the factory, they know, you know, changing motors, whatever. But the efficiency part, sometimes, you know, just is not there. Again, combining these things, having a holistic approach. Or let's say wind turbines, okay? How much power I can generate? Well, you know, if you try to analyze a turbine, it is very complicated. And you need to know what is available there. And what is available there? Just the kinetic energy, okay? And you know the swept area here by the blades. If you know the kinetic energy, okay? You know you cannot go beyond that. It is your potential. And then using the efficiency value, which is about 30%, you know how much power you can generate before you install the turbine there. Same, let's say, with hydroelectric power plants, okay? Again, that elevation and the flow rate available, that really determines the whole thing. The rest is simply efficiency. And sometimes, you know, you got claims like that fan delivers, you know, so much fluid. How can you check? Again, using thermodynamics, not fluid mechanics. That is, you know the diameter and everything here, and you know that, and you also know the power consumed by the fan. In the limiting case, that electric power will be converted to kinetic energy, conservation of energy, kind of, which is very easy to calculate. Okay, it is simply V square over 2, right? And then you can calculate, let's say, the mass flow rate there, and divide that by the area, you get the average velocity, and you can have a very good idea about the claim, okay? If it can reach the claimed velocity there. And, you know, storytelling, associated things within a historical context. People love stories, okay? So if, let's say, you teach within stories and you learn by imagining and associating stories, I think it is very effective. For example, steam engines. In the past, there was no such thing as thermodynamics. Industrial revolution, right? Well, the history of thermodynamics is really the history of industrial revolution because of the steam engines there. And steam engines are not built using the principles of thermodynamics. To the contrary, the science of thermodynamics, it evolved by observing steam engines, okay? You know, experimenting with them, trying different things, and then trying to discover the basic principles which is behind it. Let's say eggs, okay? We all boil eggs, right? In heat transfer, okay, trying to, when I teach heat transfer, I sometimes spend like 30 minutes on how to boil eggs, okay? Because I think you can teach a lot of basic things using this. Here, I don't have much time, so I will not go through it, but simply the initial temperature here, right? The size of the egg, and then the temperature, the boiling temperature, which changes with elevation. And then the level of boiling, which is the convection coefficient there. You know, all those things affect the cooking time. Therefore, in real life, like we have, if you want the egg like a little runny in a certain way, you have to boil it like 4 minutes or 5 minutes, okay? It's baloney. Depends on all these variables. It is very different if you take an egg from the refrigerator, boil it, or what I do personally, if I boil egg the next day, I take the eggs out of the refrigerator, leave it in the kitchen counter so that they're at the room temperature. I save energy and it boils, you know, faster, for example. Anyway, and also money. In heat transfer, you can calculate the heat loss through the roof of a building, right? Flat building there. But you know, it is just a number. Okay, it is 1.69 kilowatt. Okay. How can you make it stick with associated with money? For example, this is electrically heated, okay? And the cost is like 8 cents per kilowatt hour, okay? Well, just multiply it. What do you get? $1.35. It sticks to the mine. That heat loss from the roof under those conditions, okay, during a night is costing me more than $1, okay? Kando, you know, raises our consciousness there. You become more conscientious about, let's say, the heat loss, because you know heat loss is money loss. And let's say cold drinks. I think a very simple example, how much does it cost to cool a canned drink, a soda here, okay? Using, let's say, the COP or the refrigerator, whatever. You know, very simple example. But you learn all the basics about the energy needed and the cost associated with this. Okay, let me just, we are running out of, we are almost done with time. Let's say another misconception. In India, many parts you don't have this problem because the weather is warm. But in Turkey, many people think that you should leave the heater on in winter or the air conditioner on when you go to work, because when you come back home in the evening, for the heater to raise the temperature again, or for the cooler to drop the temperature, it spends more energy. So it is a common misconception that you leave the heater or air conditioner on. Okay, again, baloney. Nothing can be farther than the truth. What is the proof? Let's say you come home, okay, and then it is hot inside. You turn the air conditioner on. How long does it take for the temperature to drop to comfortable level, or turn the heater on to go up to a comfortable level? Usually no more than 15 minutes, right? That means after 15 minutes, you are back to normal. But if you leave it on the whole day, probably it will run, what, 5, 6, 10 hours there. Okay, pure logic. But these are misconceptions, sometimes amazing. Also, the intuitive understanding, let's say suddenly you are heating something, a surface, okay? Now, will the temperature rise here? Or how much will it rise? Let's say you leave your telephone outside or something. How much will the surface temperature rise? Well, it depends on how much heat enters, and that depends on the conductivity here, if it heat is to leave from the other side, or if it is solar heating, the reflectivity of the surface. So for example, in this problem, if you have wood, the temperature will rise to 140 degrees. If let's say you have aluminum, the temperature will not rise at all, okay, within the given time. Why? Because aluminum is very conductive, okay? If you wanted the temperature to rise, probably you will have to heat it from all sides there. Okay, you can use analogies, and then you can use also comparisons. For example, a single pane window versus a double pane. And people usually think that, well, you know, glass is important. Maybe we should use a thicker glass. No. Using air here, which is free, okay, it reduces the heat loss drastically. Why? Because the conductivity of air, is very, very, very low, okay? As a result, it really serves as insulation. So look at the result. You have like a single 8 millimeter thick glass, and then 2 4-millimeter thick glasses with air in between. Heat loss goes down from 266 to just 69. Kind of, you know, a comparison in heat transfer, okay? And then explaining why that happens. Because air is really, the thermal conductivity is comparable to best insulations there. Attaching meaning, for example, thermal contact resistance in heat transfer, okay? We have hard time to visualize the effect. But if let's say you determine the equivalent of an aluminum layer, then people can visualize it. For example, in this example, the thermal contact resistance causes a resistance to heat transfer to a certain amount, okay? And it is equivalent to, like in this case, about a 2 centimeter thick aluminum, the thermal resistance caused by it. Kind of, you know, visualizing the result also helps deep understanding there. And often we have a hard time understanding thermal comfort because we ignore radiation. We always think the temperature of the environment. We are conditioned by it. The, you know, thermostats, whatever, okay? And, but you can show that the heat transfer by radiation is also very significant, okay? And you can improve thermal comfort you can reduce the heating costs by involving radiation. That is using the different mechanisms of heat transfer there. On derivations, now students usually hate derivations. Okay, look at this differential equation here. Okay, it makes no sense, right? This is the one-dimensional heat conduction transient equation in homogeneous media. Look at that differential equation. But it is really distinct, very intuitive, very physical. What is it? Let's say you have a layer here, okay, a differential thickness or finite thickness. We know that during heat conduction, heat will enter there, will be conducted. And then heat will leave from the other side. There's heat leaving. And then you may have a generation, like you may have electrical, chemical reactions or whatever, okay? And then this should be, the end result should be the change in the energy content of this layer, right? Now, this is very intuitive. This is easy to understand. But you cannot, you know, do calculations with this expression. So you express it in symbols, okay? And then you do some mathematics, some manipulations, and then you get this result. Now, just to show that this thing is the same as that thing, okay? So the derivations are important, but seeing the whole picture is also important, okay? That is to skip a lot of details and then to always associate a differential equation with the physical expression. In fluid mechanics, you know, we have a lot of equations, but at the end, they are conservation of mass, momentum in different directions, and energy. That's it. You know, those basic physical concepts, really. Mass, momentum, and energy. All those, you know, huge Navier-Stokes equations, you know, all those things with a lot of, you know, partial differentials there, right? Which scares, you know, the hell out of us. They are really simply basic conservation relations there. Balance relations. We balance the mass, balance the momentum, and balance the energy. That's it. Behind all those complicated equations. Let me finish with this example. Let's say this is a heat exchanger, okay? Shell and tube heat exchanger. And we use it a lot in the industry. I'm sure some lecturers from the industry, they will also go through these. And they involve fluid flow, thermodynamics, heat transfer, okay? Some holistic approach there. Now, a few months ago, I got a call from a geothermal power company. What happens here is they had like 2,000 tubes, a huge heat exchanger. They are heating pentane, using brine. But they also have steam. Because geothermal brine, when the pressure drops, the non-condensable gases and they separate, and then some liquid vaporizes. So the heat exchanger was two parts. About two-thirds of it liquid, one-third steam. The steam enters from the steam part, and then together they heat the pentane, which goes to the turbine to generate power. After several years, the non-condensable gases, they disappeared, and there is very little steam. So it is, you know, performing very badly. And they have a few plants, okay? And they have the same problem, three plants there. It has been that way for, I think, more than a year. One option is to replace the heat exchanger, which is costing like $500,000, okay? So that you have only brine tubes, okay? you get rid of the steam. The other option is what comes to mind. Maybe I can put also brine here, but it was designed for steam. What will happen here? So a lot of confusion. So they asked me, you know, to do an analysis. And what I did is I simply calculated, okay, the steam part, about one third, if we were to replace the steam by the brine, okay? Both are at 160 degrees there, okay? And this is the secondary heat exchanger, so regular brine enters at about 130 there. And they were wondering if it would have any adverse effects, whatever. Anyway, I showed to them that if they simply take the brine, additional brine, from the well, the geothermal wells, and combine the steam from the three power plants into one, because it is enough for one plant, and then use entirely new brine here. I did the analysis, the fluid flow, you know, thermodynamic, and then the heat exchanger, heat transfer analysis. And it just, you know, the numbers matched perfectly. You don't need additional tubes. You don't need additional or a new heat exchanger there. I told them that they can go ahead and try it, and the performance will go back to original value based on analysis. You know, thermodynamics, heat transfer, and flow. Sure enough, they did that. Okay, they were, you know, a little kind of what? Well, if what if anything goes wrong? What if it doesn't really work? Because there is not much confidence in, you know, analysis unless you try it. But in this case, I was, you know, very confident because you know, all the aspects are there, and material wise, I made sure there is no problem. Okay. Well, sure enough, it worked beautifully. That is a holistic approach. Okay. Using, you know, the different sciences, consideration of relevant things, like you are replacing steam with brine, okay, is the material right there? I learned that, you know, the tube material is the same, it's the same as the brine tubes, so that there is no surprise there, okay? So by using a combined approach, okay, doing different kinds of analysis, you solve a problem. And this is what is important in engineering, solving problems. It is what, you know, they pay us for. They pay, you know, good money to engineers to solve problems. But that also requires expertise in relevant areas. And sometimes it is not enough. So it is very important to work in teams. So teamwork, being able, you know, for people of different expertise areas to work together on the same problem, okay, to end up with the best possible solution, of course, also considering the economics. My last message is really to appreciate simplicity. And a good solution doesn't have to be expensive, doesn't have to be complicated. As Einstein said, make everything as simple as possible, but not simpler. That is, maintain the essence, but get rid of the unnecessary details there to make it simple. So I'll stop here, and I thank you very much for your attention. And if there are any questions or comments, I'd be glad to entertain them.
Thank you, sir. We have a hand raised by Rekha Dinesh. Ma'am? Okay. Now, this is the interaction time. If you have any questions, may ask to our chief guest. Please.
It looks like everything is crystal clear, right? This is what you get when you make things simple. I think people think, oh, everything is so simple that, that there is no need to ask any questions. I mean, everyone understands it, right?
Exactly. Abogasan?
May I audible?
Yeah, madam.
Yeah. It's my pleasure to hear ask questions to Yunus and this, sir, because we are following his test for teaching fluid mechanics in our college. So it's very grateful and thank to all the organizers for making such a session. So my question is, sir, I'm a teacher and I am guiding so many students for the project work. Can you suggest some important topics in taking as a project work or to give to the students on this fluid mechanics area? Some simple one, I think we can, it's very useful to the students to convey this message, because I am attending a class along with an author and getting some ideas from the author. Can you suggest some topics, sir?
What kind of topics do you have in mind? If you can, I think, clarify the question, what kind of suggestion topics are you talking about?
Based on this fluid mechanics area, our students are PG students and UG students, we are handling the classes. So could you give some suggestions or some topic ideas to give the to take the students faster doing their project work during their BTEC and PG studies?
Okay, I think your voice, you know, comes and goes, but let me try. I think you are asking for suggestions for the students learning fluid mechanics. Probably suggestions for topics or something. The main suggestion to the students is to really be observant. That is to observe, okay, the things associated with fluid mechanics in their homes, the things that they use, and then in real life, in, let's say, whatever devices they use, to be observant and try to identify the phenomena there. For example, in the kitchen, when you turn the faucet on, the water flows, and then turn it off, all you are doing is really introducing head loss. That is, we study head loss in fluid mechanics, right? The pressure drop, whatever, kind of destroying that, pressure there. When you turning a valve, to control the fluid flow, you are basically introducing head loss there, And if, let's say, you increase the head loss, the flow rate decreases. Kind of, to associate the concepts together there. And let's say when you use a fan, again you are converting, let's say, electrical energy to fluid energy, the velocity, whatever. Kind of, I think, incorporating and associating what is in real life, whether it is at home or at the workplace there, and to really be observant. For example, one consulting work I did, a textile factory, they had problems with the compressor, They compressed air wasn't enough. They were considering buying a new compressor, a larger one. And, I went to their compressor room, and I noticed that the compressor room is not ventilated, much. The air inside is hot, and then the compressor pulls in the hot air. And now we know that at atmospheric pressure, the density is inversely proportional with temperature, right? So although you have the same number of revolutions, there the compressor is working, it takes in the same volume, but less air. So my suggestion to them was simply do some ductwork from the compressor inlet to the outside, okay, outside the compressor room, and pull in fresh air, okay? And I said, let's try this first. This is the easiest, cheapest solution. And there is a good chance this may solve your problem. And if it doesn't, we will look into, you know, other complex things. And I also told them that they should check the air leaks, because when I visit a factory, you can kind of hear the, you know, whistling sounds there, okay? And then that means, you know, you have air leaks. And do this and also check the air leaks, and then let's talk again. They did that. Their problem was solved. You know, just common sense, okay? And just using, I think, pure logic and starting with the simplest possible solutions, okay? If let's say we give this message to the students and also give examples from real life, I think the nice thing about this training session is that you have, I think, a lot of speakers, some from the industry, so those such experiences will be shared. If let's say they are put together, then I think the students will get that habit, you know, be observant, and also when they see problems, kind of possible ways of solving them based on what they have learned and based on the fundamentals, based on their experiences.
Next hand is Sanjay. Sanjay, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Sir, am I audible?
Yes, I hear you.
Thank you, sir. It gives me an immense pleasure to interact with you, sir. And I thank my college also for this. Sir, I'm a mechanical engineering graduate, sir. Sir, I would like to ask you a question. Sir, can you suggest some tips to develop a mind which is able to relate pure engineering theory to everyday practical things which we see? Because I think that is a mind which actually do the real engineering works. So if you see, if you study any theory part, can you give us some tips such that we could easily relate that to some practical scenarios and learn that very fastly?
Okay. I think that's important question, and it needs to be emphasized. So how do we relate the theory to practice? Boltzmann, who is one of the founders of thermodynamics, he says, there is nothing more practical than a good theory. Okay? Why? Because the theory is the condensed form of practice. What is theory? Theory is really the natural phenomena that governs everything in the universe, okay? It is the reason that there is a saying, it says, the laws of nature are the invisible government of the universe, or the constitution of the universe. So the constitution, all the laws of physics, imagine now, in a country you know the laws, okay, versus you observe everything and try to infer the laws by experimenting. If you do experimenting yourself, it may take a lifetime and you can learn only a little, okay? But if you, let's say in traffic, if you just take a book with the laws, with the rules and laws of traffic, okay, read it, then you know all the rules, you know what to do when you go into traffic. Of course, you don't do it, but at least you know what the right thing is to do there. In sciences, the same way. In sciences, the same way, okay? The theory is the combined result of all the practice, okay? Therefore, if you try to gain that knowledge, you will have to do a lot of experiments, a lot of, you know, experience, a lot of trials and errors, and then you wouldn't be so sure. I think we should be very clear in our mind that without a theory, we have no knowledge base. We start from zero, okay? So the theory is very important. Now, what is the problem here? To really fail to associate the theory with the practice, okay? So it is very important to show the derivation of the equations using the physical concepts, okay? So that, you know, from Bernoulli's equation to, you know, whatever, okay? To show where they come from, what is the physical base, and then to apply it to real life situations, okay? And to show the importance and to show that without a theory, you wouldn't be able to do that. So the students should really appreciate the theory more than sporadic practice, because you need a lot of practice to draw a conclusion and express it in one sentence or one expression. The theory does that for you. Right now you learn everything in 4 years, right? But without the theory, in 4 years, you could learn only, you know, a fraction of what you are learning, okay? Let me give one example. A company in Reno, they were doing liquid methane pumps. They were manufacturing, okay? And then pumps and turbines are, you know, the same devices really, running in reverse. And the company thought about manufacturing turbines, okay, to replace valves. In the liquefaction of natural gas, they use, you know, large pressure drops through valves. And the idea was the valves waste the mechanical energy, the pressure energy there, if you use a turbine, okay? And then we can simply recover that energy and produce electricity, power. But, you know, it wasn't intuitive. They couldn't convince the management. And then they hired one of my students, and the student contacted me. He said that there's a project of this kind, so can you do an analysis? I said, you know, why not? I did the analysis on the paper, thermodynamic analysis, and I showed them, okay, how much power the turbine will generate, okay, what the temperature drop will be, which is another advantage, and then how much the economical benefits, the payback period, whatever, okay? Without any experimental data. How did I do that? Using entropy, okay? Which is, you know, a vague concept, right? Entropy. And without entropy, no way to do that analysis. The only way is to do expensive experiments. By using the property entropy and using the isentropic process for the best case, okay? I determine, let's say, the best case scenario for the turbine, And without entropy, I cannot do it. And then in real life, I know the efficiencies are like, you know, about 85-90%. Okay, using that efficiency to come to the back to the real world, I did, you know, all the predictions. They were convinced Shell was the prospective customer. Shell was convinced. They got their first contract for 6 turbines at a price of $1 million. And the payback period was like 6 months. Okay. So the company made good money. Shell, as a customer, they saved a lot of money. Okay. And I think it was good for the environment there. So I think that shows the importance of theory, even concepts like entropy, which is not really, doesn't have a physical correspondence there. If let's say we relate the theory to practice well, then I don't think the students will have that problem that much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Any other questions? Okay.
Comment box, there is a question.
Comment box.
From Dr. Sanu Krishna.
That question is, I think it's related to the first question, sir. Please suggest view emerging trends in fluid mechanics as a research area.
Okay. I hope that all the participants might have benefited. Listening to this wonderful session, what I noticed is that the importance of simplicity is highlighted. We may not directly observe these simple things, but the importance of simplicity and also importance of intuitive understanding is illustrated through many simple real life related examples. So these examples and these explanations, and the examples is selected, will be very useful to all of us in getting an insight to the fluid mechanics. We thank once again Professor Yunus Sanjal for his wonderful session, and also we would like to get associated with you in future also. Thank you, sir. So thank all the participants, and hope they will be surely benefited from this. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for the nice comments, and it was a pleasure to be here this Monday morning in Turkey, and I wish you all a very good training program.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.